are very excited to host this event by Kristen Hawkins. Kristen was hired in 2006 to launch Students for Life of America's full-time operation. Students for Life is dedicated to abolishing abortion by identifying, equipping, and mobilizing this pro-life generation, which are the direct targets of today's abortion industry. After college, she served the Republican National Committee and as a presidential appointee in the George W. Bush administration at the Department of Health and Human Services. She was recruited to be the president of Students for Life in 2006. Since then, she has taken a small group of a few dozen student pro-life groups scattered around the nation and, alongside her incredible team, has multiplied that number to over 1,100 organized Students for Life groups in all 50 states. She is the author of Courageous, Students Abolishing Abortion in This Lifetime. She has interviewed on Fox News, CNN, MSNBC, The Today Show, CBS, ABC, and HBO, and has recently received the title of one of the four worst anti-abortion misinformers. She has done this all while being a wife to her husband, raising her four lovely children, and in her free time, volunteering at the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation. Since launching Students for Life, the pro-life generation has been given a voice, and they are using that voice to demand abortion's end. And here is Kristen Hawkins.
Jonathan, who is at home right now. You're not my husband, I'm talking to you. Who's at home right now with our four children, Gunner, Bear, Gracie, and Maverick, and whose support makes all of this possible with me traveling and being gone all the time. And don't worry, he was well fed. I spent all yesterday afternoon making my man's meal. So, now, while I know some of the statements I'll make tonight will be controversial, I appreciate it if you would hold your questions until the end, and then we can have a Q&A time. I'm sure we'll have a great discussion. I want to tell you a little bit. I'm going to start out telling you a little bit about my story. I grew up in a small town in West Virginia. You'll notice some of the accent throughout the speech, so you can try to find those words. I grew up with my parents and my younger sister. My father was raised by mostly a single mother, lived in poverty his whole life. Thankfully, he graduated high school, got a good paying blue collar job after graduating high school that sadly he's hated for the past 40 years, but thankfully will be retiring in the next few months. And when I think about and I look back at my life and I think about how I got here, running Students for Life of America, doing all the crazy things that being a pro-life activist entails, I always think about my father. I think about my dad. I remember him being that main motivator in my life, always pushing me to be the best, to do my best. And his reasons for it always were, you have to be the best, you have to get good grades, you have to get a scholarship to college, you've got to get your degree so you can choose the life you want, you can choose the career path that you want. And it was tough growing up sometimes with Gary as my dad. I remember in first grade going and having to ask for extra credit because I got a B in some of the math. I had to get an English tutor when I was in fifth grade so that I was a humanities. I had to get straight A's. And now I am a pro at Oxford commas. You can ask anybody who works for me that Oxford commas are mandatory, and they're one of the first questions I ask when you're interviewing for your job, because Oxford commas do matter. And I can do a whole speech on that later. But this is my childhood. Of working hard, getting good grades, and really having those conversations with my dad when we were going back and forth from softball or volleyball, of talking about his hopes and dreams for my life. And I always knew that I wanted to get married, that I wanted to have children. That was always sort of the plan too, that I was going to go to college, have a career, I wanted to be an aeronautical engineer. I kind of drifted far from that. But I knew I wanted to get married, I knew I wanted kids. I thought maybe like one or two kids, like four kids is crazy for my family, and my life is a little crazy. But I knew I wanted that. I saw my mom. My mom was a public school teacher and still is, and I saw how hard she worked, how hard she was always hustling from work to home to church, back home to, she was always the first one awake, always waking me up, doing dishes in the morning, the last one awake, putting together the laundry, making sure our lunches were packed. But I knew I wanted to be that I wanted to be a working mom too. And if you would have asked me in high school, if you would have asked me in college, are you a feminist, Kristen? I would have said, hell yeah, I'm a feminist, of course. I made better grades than all the guys in my class. I never once doubted my equality with men at my school. I didn't have, I didn't struggle to kind of find my voice. This is something like God naturally gifted me with to be outspoken. But today at 32, yes, I'm 32, I know. This is great. Being chubby helps. If you would ask me, Kristen, are you a feminist? And I actually get asked this a lot. I'm pretty sure I don't want that label. Because even though I'm pretty damn sure my life is a testament to what those first wave and second wave feminists, what they envisioned for our lives as women, I'm pretty sure my life is a testament to that. That I won that full ride scholarship to college. That I was able to choose the career that I wanted to choose. That I was able to get married. I was able to have children. My family life is untraditional. My husband stopped teaching a few years ago. He is now a full-time stay-at-home dad. He educates our children. I'm the Magister of Latin. I did pick up Latin this year, but my husband does the rest of it. We have an untraditional sort of life. And I think about those second-wave feminists and what Betty Friedan was talking about in A Feminist Mystique. I think she was talking about equality. I live it. I'm proof that it happens. Have there been jerks that I've encountered? Yeah. But usually it's both sexes. So it's usually equal opportunity. I have never felt like because I'm a woman, because of my biology, that I'm being held down. But I think that if you would ask today's mainstream feminists, is Kristen Hawkins, President of Students for Life, a feminist, they would say no. They would say no. And it would be because of one issue, abortion. I don't fit within mainstream feminism. I'm not welcome. And in fact, the first wave feminists, the egalitarian maternal feminists, Susan B. Anthony, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, Alice Paul, Frances Willard, they wouldn't fit today's definition of mainstream feminism either. This was demonstrated perfectly this January when we were in Washington, D.C. And after the election of President Trump, there was this women's march that was announced. I emailed them the next day and I said, hey, Students for Life would be honored to partner with the women's march because that's what we do. We're here to save women, to help women. And all of those requests were turned down. Other pro-life groups had applied and were accepted. Then they were revoked. So we went to the Women's March. We were there protesting. We had a 20-foot banner that led the Women's March that said, abortion betrays women. I was there when the women would look up at the sign and they'd be holding an immigration sign or an F Trump sign or whatever. They would see our abortion betrays women. They would look up, they would kind of nod and look back down. That's why we were there. We were there for this generation of young people that are being targeted every day. Every single day on our campuses, we're being told, no, you can't do it all. No, you aren't strong enough. We were there for this generation that's been misogynistically told for the past 20 years, since Planned Parenthood versus Casey, that abortion is needed in a woman's life in order for her to achieve success in the business world. That's why we were there. And while I wasn't invited to speak at the Women's Convention this Saturday in Detroit, we'll be there. That's where I'm heading after this. I brought my coat, so I'm ready to go. We'll be there standing with the pro-life generation, showing the women who enter that convention that there is another way, that the majority of American women today, majority of our generation, actually agree. They actually agree that abortion is morally wrong. Men and women, I reject those lies of mainstream feminists. I reject those lies that say that abortion is going to make me free, that abortion is needed to ensure my freedom, that I have to pay someone to commit a violent act upon someone weaker than me, upon someone smaller than me, in order to have control of my body and my life. Abortion has and always, always will be the opposite of empowerment. And I would argue that it has no place in civil society. Empowering women for greatness isn't telling them to go to the Planned Parenthood down the street, to not talk about the problem, to get rid of it. But what happened to feminism in America? When did the fight for equality become an extremist abortion agenda that literally advocates for committing violence against other human beings? Throughout the years and the different waves of feminism, there's always been a few core principles that have remained constant. One is the discipline of nonviolence, the demand of equality, and the understanding that one human being should never oppress or treat another human being like they are property. These core values define what abortion is. While some abortion advocates will try to muddy the conversation, saying, oh, there's conflicting views about when life begins, the profound reality is that it's simple. It's science. It's biology. That we learn these definitions of when life begins in elementary and in middle school. But regardless of whether or not you believe in that science, abortion is always the violent destruction of a human being. It's oppressing other people. It's oppressing someone who's smaller and weaker than you. At its core, abortion should always be considered anti-feminist. And our feminist foremothers, that first wave of feminists, the suffragists, they agreed with this. Mary Wollstonecraft, the early British philosopher who wrote The Vindication of Rights of Woman, the book that Susan B. Anthony based much of her work off of. She wrote, women becoming constantly weaker in mind and body than they ought to be were one of the grand ends of their being taken into account. That bearing and nursing children have not sufficient strength to discharge the first duty of a mother, and sacrificing to lavishness the parental affection and ennobles instinct either destroy the embryo in the womb or cast it off when it is born. Nature and everything demands respect, and those who violate her laws seldom do with impunity. If you Google Mary Wollstonecraft, she wasn't an old conservative prude in the 1790s. Elizabeth Cady Stanton, she fought for women's rights for 60 years. She was active in the slavery abolitionist movement alongside her husband. Became frustrated that the slavery abolitionists didn't embrace female leadership. She wrote an article on infanticide saying, there must be a remedy for a crying evil as this, but where shall it be found at least begin, if not in the complete enfranchisement and elevation of women? See, these first wave feminists saw abortion for what it really is. They understood that it's not a choice. They understood it's something that a woman feels and she's trapped and has nowhere else to turn. Victoria Woodhull, she was the first woman to declare her candidacy for presidency. She was one of the first female stockbrokers in New York. She and her sister wrote an article called The Slaughter of Innocence. Wives deliberately permit themselves to become pregnant of children and then to prevent becoming mothers and deliberately murder them while yet in their wombs. Can there be a more demoralized condition than this? We are aware that many women attempt to excuse themselves from procuring abortions upon the ground that is not murder, but the fact of resort to so weak an argument only shows the more palpably and that they fully realize the enormity of their crime. Dr. Elizabeth Blackwell, one of the first women in America to earn a medical degree, she wrote her diary about the famous Madame Restel, the abortionist in New York City. She said, the gross perversion, destruction of motherhood by the abortionists filled me with such indignation and awakened active enticement that the honorable term female physician should be exclusively applied to those women who carried on this shocking trade seemed to me a horror. It was utter degradation of what might and should be a noble position for women. And let's not forget to mention Susan B. Anthony. woman who founded the newspaper, The Revolution, who is the most well-known suffragist in our nation. Her magazine refused to print any ads for abortifacient drugs, which were popular at the time and quite lucrative. In one article she wrote, "Guilty? Yes, no matter what the motive, love of ease or desire to save from suffering the unborn innocent, the woman is awfully guilty who commits the deed. It will burden her conscience in life. It will burden her soul in death. But oh, thrice guilty is he who, for selfish gratification, heedless of her prayers, indifferent to her fate, drove her to the desperation which impels her to the crime." And then think about Alice Paul, the original author of the ERA. Any of you seen Iron Jawed Angels? I feel like our generation learned about Alice Paul. Alice Paul said, "Abortion is the ultimate exploitation of women." And she predicted dead on what was going to happen with second wave feminism in the 1960s and 1970s. 40 years after the 19th Amendment, 40 years after women won the right to vote, feminism was kicked off again. World War II is over. We started focusing here in the United States on the justices that were happening here. There was the Equal Pay Act of 1963, the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which actually included provisions prohibiting sex discrimination. Contrary to Betty, you know, what people think, Betty Friedan's first edition of Feminist Mystique didn't even include a mention of contraception or abortion. Her book wasn't this big rallying cry for abortion or sexual liberation. It addressed the restlessness and the unhappiness many women felt despite having what their husbands thought was it all. They had a home, their husband had a good job, they had money. That's what it was addressing. Yet it was two men, Larry Lather, a journalist, biographer of Margaret Sanger, and Bernard Nathanson, an abortionist, who founded NARAL, National Association for Repeal of Abortion Laws, who actually met with Betty. They knew her from circles in New York City, and they sold her on the lie. They sold her on the lie that abortion was needed in order for their movement, in order for the feminist movement, the movement for women's equality, to be successful. Lather was a firm believer in the impending demographic bomb, which we all know never happened. He came to see abortion, actually, as the ultimate solution. To rid the world of too many people, he thought we could just kill them. According to Bernard Nathanson's personal accounts, Lather had told him that they had to move abortion from like that yucky eugenics movement of the early 1900s. He had to move it away from this eugenics white upper middle class movement to the women who were beginning to lead a new cause. Let me make this really clear. It was two men who hijacked the women's rights movement, the women's equality movement, for their personal gain. Now tonight, I'm not arguing that women go back to the restlessness in the 1950s, the 1950s housewife. I'm not arguing that we have to be barefoot and pregnant in order to be free and happy. Although I will say I do love my apron. And I wear it all the time. Because it's all boiled down to one thing, abortion. Today in America, women have full equality under law. We have incredible freedoms in the United States, freedoms that women in other nations can't even hope to have. We can be successful and achieve our dreams. We can live without fear of genital mutilation. We can live in fear without having to be sold off to an abusive husband at the age of 12. We can live without the fear of being robbed of our human rights. We can own property. We can inherit property and wealth. We can achieve our educational goals. We can work in the career of our choice. We can drive cars. And I can even walk in front or beside men in my family. We've achieved so much. Yeah, if you ask mainstream feminists, the abortion industry, what's going on, they'll say, no, we're under attack. Women's rights are under attack. Stand up, fight back. I've heard this for hours on end, the protests. Because they've integrated our interests and our successful life into this quest for abortion, hormonal contraception. That's it. And by the way, it has to be free, taxpayer funded. Because that's what's going to make us happy. That's what's going to achieve fulfillment. And they've institutionalized this belief everywhere. In the words of the abortion worker who told my friend Allie, it's only 10 minutes, it'll be over, you can go back to life as normal. In the words of the college administrator at Fordham University, a Catholic university, who told my friend Eleanor, well, you can have an abortion and keep your scholarship and live on campus, or you can stay pregnant, but you can't live here and you're going to lose your $10,000 scholarship. This has been institutionalized everywhere. We've been sold a bag of lies. We've been sold a bag of lies to these mainstream feminists. The first lie is that sex is without compromise. Right now, in 2017, with all the technology, with everything that we have, we are in the midst of a self-proclaimed STD epidemic from the CDC, where 1 in 2 before the age of 25 will have a sexually transmitted disease. Don't think that lie is being repeated? Just ask our Students for Life group at Baldwin Wallace College. They were denied at the end of last week a table at the LGBTQ-sponsored Sex Week Fair because, and I quote, the Students for Life group is not sex positive because they were going to talk about abortion. Once sex was taken outside of marriage and made it something casual, of course hormonal birth control and abortion had to follow because sex was for fun. You weren't trying to get pregnant. You didn't promise to spend your life with this person. You weren't trying to create a legacy or a family. You weren't committed to working together for the rest of your lives. The fact is, every decision we make, every action we take, it has a consequence. Whether that consequence is popular or not, it has a consequence. And guess what? Sex has interesting consequences. Some are inconvenient and embarrassing, like rashes. Some are deadly, like HIV and cervical cancer. Some come with 18-year-plus commitments of childbearing. Once sex was taken out of this lifelong commitment, we had to be sold a second lie. That contraception is necessary for the advancement of women. Today, if you go to the Smithsonian Museum in Washington, there's a huge thing about contraception and Margaret Sanger, how she freed women. Really? Because what they've told women for generations is that our fertility is not a gift. It's something to be suppressed. It's something to be controlled. In recent years, now it's everyone's contraception and everyone's for free. And who cares about the consequences? Look, we know men and women are different. Again, hashtag science. Biology tells us this. Social scientists overwhelmingly know that there is a biological difference between a male and a female. You don't have to look very much further than to look at the brain and to see, now women, hello, this is why we're awesome. Our brains are actually more networked than men's brains. If you ever wonder why your husband or your boyfriend can't like do more than one thing at a time, it's because we have more neurons connecting the left and right hemispheres. Do you all know that medications for mental disorders, they work differently on men and women? You can't prescribe the same amount of medication for a woman you can for a man because our brains are literally wired differently. If you don't believe me, check out, Google the work of Stephen Rhodes. He's a professor at UVA who's written about this. He wrote, ignoring these differences is more damaging for women than it is for men because the goal of a gender-aligned society tends to transform itself into a goal of making women more like men. As a result, male interests, values, and priorities set the agenda for women aspiring to break into the ranks of power. I don't want to become a man. I'm okay with being a woman. We know from the writings of the first wave feminists that they actually opposed contraception because they believed it allowed the promiscuity of men. That's what we have today. A generation of men who use our bodies and then when we're pregnant say, oh, get it taken care of. I'll have $500 next week. Pornography addiction, it's not even controversial anymore. both left and right, conservative and liberal, all agree we have a problem in our country. We've seen the studies that talk about how this hormonal birth control doesn't prevent unplanned pregnancies. There was a fascinating article that came out from the British Pregnancy Advisory Service, BPAS. They're the UK's Planned Parenthood. They are the UK's largest abortion vendor. And in their study that they conducted, they are an abortion group. This is their study. This is not made up facts. It turns out that over half of women, 51%, who procured abortions do so because of failure of their contraceptive method. In fact, the study of over 60,000 women found that contraceptive use contributes to a greater likelihood that women will have later term abortions because they assume they can't get pregnant using contraception and miss early pregnancy signs as a result. In response to the study, the executive director of BPAS said, "Our data shows women cannot control their fertility through contraception alone. Even when they're using some of the most effective methods, family planning is contraception as well as abortion. Abortion is birth control that women need when their regular method lets them down." And I'm not even getting into the scientific articles about how hormonal contraception is bad for our bodies. The fact that we know that it actually increases our risk of breast cancer. There was a study conducted by the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center, funded by the National Cancer Institute, that said birth control pills, high-dose birth control pills, can increase your chances of getting breast cancer threefold. Moderate-dose estrogen birth controls, like most of the birth control pills that are prescribed today, increases at 1.6 times. The top prescribed birth control pill, more than 4.8 million scripts issued, increased breast cancer risk by 20%. The fifth most prescribed pill increased breast cancer risk by 60%. We don't eat meat with hormones in it or buy milk that's not organic, but yet we think that there's nothing wrong with putting dangerous drugs into our bodies. And we don't ask any questions. We just don't ask any questions. I don't even have to mention that the World Health Organization has already labeled hormonal birth control as a group 1 carcinogen. That's the same category as cigarettes and asbestos. This is what we tell women that they have to have, that they have to be. And most women wouldn't even know these facts because it's not discussed. And quite frankly, talking about it makes people angry. Because many of us were on birth control at one point, or still are on birth control at some point. And it's personal. Anytime I talk about this, I'll get like a slew of tweets and hate emails and told I'm fat or ugly and no one would have sex with me. That's why I'm against contraception. I'm told that a lot. That's what we have. You can't talk about it in the country because it's gospel truth. Any discussion of it is unfair. It's mean. Now, when contraception fails, which the leading abortion vendor in the UK just said to us, then we have to be sold the third and fourth lies of mainstream feminism. And that is that abortion is needed for women to achieve their goals. And that abortion is harmless. It's safe. Let's start with the fact that today's abortion debate really isn't about whether or not abortion kills. We know this. In 1995, feminist Naomi Wolf wrote in the New Republic, "The statement that abortion stops the beating heart is true." Pro-abortion feminist Camille Paglia wrote in Salon, "I've always frankly admitted that abortion is murder, the extermination of the powerless by the powerful." In Conscience, a Catholic magazine founder of Catholics for Choice President Francis Kiesling declared that the fetus does have value. Now, the argument I find myself in most of the time when I'm on campuses, when our teens on campuses, is whether or not women's freedom and well-being demands legal access to abortion. Does it demand access to abortion? You see, as we've gone from trying to truly serve pregnant women to helping women in that moment of crisis and confusion to simply telling her, just Google abortion, Planned Parenthood's down the street. Which most of the time they are. Planned Parenthood, 79% of them are 5 miles from a college campus because this is their target audience. As she seeks advice from her boyfriend or friends or family, she's going to hear that feminist mantra repeated over and over again. It's your body, your choice. Your body, your choice. And the subtext of that is to go have the abortion. When I wrote our book a few years ago, I interviewed a lot of girls, young girls that we had worked with on campuses, some who got pregnant and chosen to keep their baby, raise a child, some who placed for adoption, some who had abortions. The one thing I found that was common amongst all the girls that I spoke with, and I interviewed for this book, was in every single case, they went to multiple people in their lives and said, what should I do? What should I do? I don't know what to do. In every single case where the young girl chose abortion, it was because no one told her, you don't have to do this. All she heard was, it's your body, it's your choice. And in her mind, that was code for go get it taken care of. Instead of finding encouragement or reassurance and love and offers to help, she's just told just to go get it over with. That's how she's going to achieve her career goals. That's how she's going to achieve those educational goals. Because we've legalized abortion in all 9 months of pregnancy, we're one of seven nations to have abortion through all 9 months. We haven't had to have difficult conversations in our society. We actually haven't had to have that conversation about how do we help her? How do we support her? What more can we do? Because the conversation doesn't need to be had because Planned Parenthood's down the street. We know no woman ever feels enthusiasm for her abortion. I've been out there praying, you know, from the abortion facilities on Saturday morning. It's one of my least favorite things to do in the pro-life movement. But I know it's important to be there, to stand there, to be a witness, to pray for her, to pray for her child. I never see a woman skipping into Planned Parenthood, chatting animatedly on her phone, just having an abortion, be right out. Every girl who goes in, she's sobbing. She's looking down. Oftentimes she's crying before she even walks in those doors. And when she leaves, she's the exact same way. She's not there exercising her great feminist choice of abortion. She's there because she feels like she ran out of choices, that she ran out of options, that she ran out of support. First wave feminist Maddie Ringerhoff wrote, when a man steals to satisfy hunger, we may safely conclude that there is something wrong in society. So when a woman destroys the life of her unborn child, it is evidence that either by education or circumstance, she has been greatly wrong. Every single day we fail women in our country. We fail them through our own laziness. We've led her to those doors of Planned Parenthood or some other abortion facility, which are, by the way, are going to be profiting off of her despair. And the additional consequences of abortion, beyond destroying nature, her offspring, her child, the health risks are barely mentioned. Researchers in Finland have identified a strong statistical association between abortion and suicide. They found the mean annual suicide rate was 11.3 per 100,000, but the rate for women following abortion was 34.7. Three times higher. The suicide rate associated with birth, by contrast, was half the rate of all women and less than one-sixth the rate of suicide among women who had abortions. And this is from Finland, where abortion is not controversial. These are their own government stats. Over 20 studies have linked abortion to increased rates of drug and alcohol abuse. The lowest incident rate of PTSD reported following abortion is 1.5%, which translates to over 600,000 cases. Another study found it could be as high as 14%. Of American women have symptoms of PTSD and attribute them to their abortions. Analysis of nearly 15 years of published research published in the British Journal of Psychiatry, not fake news, found that women who have undergone an abortion experience an 81% increased risk of mental health problems. 2003, a landmark article in the Obstetrical and Gynecological Survey compiled the results of several studies on abortion. These show induced abortion increases the risk of placenta previa in later pregnancy by 50% and doubles the risk of preterm birth. Placenta previa, I don't know if you all know, my sister suffered from it her second pregnancy. She almost died in childbirth. So when the placenta impacts the bottom of the uterus and it covers the cervix and it often tears away and you start bleeding internally, puts the lives of both the child and the mother at risk, obviously. Preterm births account for 12.1% of births in 2002, up from 8.9% in 1980. And that is despite a national attempt, a national marketing campaign to stop preterm births, because we know how risky they are. Children who are born preterm have a 38 times greater risk of cerebral palsy. Women who give birth before 32 weeks double their breast cancer risk. This is fact. This is what happens. But we never talk about these things. Because the mainstream feminist movement just simply won't let us. They shout us down. And let me be clear. We don't need abortion vendors. We don't need abortion vendors like Planned Parenthood to prey off our generation. Planned Parenthood is the nation's largest abortion vendor, and they are the ones who drive the national narrative of the feminist movement today. It's not the NOWs or the ARL. Planned Parenthood breaks in over $1 billion a year, more than $500 million from us, the taxpayers. We give them $1 million a day. They commit 900 abortions every single day. They're the largest abortion vendor in our country, commit 320,000 abortions. They serve, they boast that they serve 2 million people every year. Do we need Planned Parenthood? We have more than 8,000 federally qualified health centers across the country that we already fund. These FQHCs serve more than 21 million women, men, and children across the country. Plus, they offer way more services than Planned Parenthood. If you're pregnant and you go into Planned Parenthood, there's one option for you. That's abortion. They don't have prenatal services. At best, you may find a Planned Parenthood that has a pamphlet on adoption that will refer you somewhere else. 94% of pregnant women who walk into Planned Parenthood's doors get an abortion. They are an abortion vendor. We don't need Planned Parenthood. I Googled them when I was in the car coming over. There's two Planned Parenthoods 5 miles from this campus. There's more than 49 federally qualified health centers within 5 miles of this campus. Those are health centers that are truly comprehensive. They provide dental care, provide well women care, who provide OB care. They're homes for people who need homes. And the really cool thing about federally qualified health centers is that if you need a service and they don't have it, they're legally obligated to drive you to a place that does. That is what we should be funding, what more money we should be putting our taxpayer dollars into. When people, we argue, defund Planned Parenthood, we're not saying take away money from women. We're saying put it where it's actually serving men and women. Did you know Planned Parenthood, they have C3, C4s, PACs? Cecile Richards went to Rolling Stone and did this great article last September about how they were putting more than $30 million into the election to back Hillary Clinton. Planned Parenthood is one of the biggest lobbyists in Washington, D.C. FQHCs, they don't have PACs. They don't have C4s. They're not involved in politics because they're about service. Planned Parenthood's driving an agenda. I can talk about that all day. I digress. Mm-hmm. I almost wore my defunct Planned Parenthood shirt, but it's a little bit more flattering. So, when she does decide to have children, when she does decide, okay, I'm good in my career, I think I can do this now, my husband's ready, he's going to put down the PlayStation. That was a cute issue. I don't think my husband's touched it since we had kids. He had, like, well, with their babies, newborns. Men, you can play PlayStation. So when you decide to have kids, then that bitch of a fifth lie of mainstream feminism comes up. And this is the one for me that I had the hardest time dealing with. Because I knew abortion was wrong. Contraception was hard to get my head around. I got that. But this was the hard one. And it's this. You can have it all, and it's easy to do. You can have it all. You can have your career and your family. Not a piece of cake. I want to hear me roar. Right? I can do it all. I'm proof that you can't, that something always has to give. It took me a lot of time to see this through. I was working 20-hour days, commuting 90 minutes back and forth from my home, and that was without traffic, sleeping in my office on my little IKEA mini couch twice a week, showering at the gym. It was keeping me in shape because I felt bad just using the shower gym, so I actually had to go do it. Giving birth, having babies, I was doing it all. But it's a constant struggle of priorities, even today. I have more than 40 team members at Students for Life. I travel all over the country. I turn down all the really cool international speaking gigs because that's too far. But it's a constant struggle. I'm up at 3 in the morning making freaking paleo beef chili before I head out. I smell like onions on the plane because I was making my husband food because somebody has to eat. Somebody has to feed the kids. It's hard. And often I get asked by young women, you know, will you be my mentor? I'm like, okay, I don't know if you want me, but sure. And the number one question I always get asked for these young girls is, I want to get married, I want kids, but I also want to have a career. How can I do it both? I say, you can, it's totally possible, but you need to understand it's extremely difficult. That's what I wasn't prepared for. That you never have enough time in the day. There literally is not enough time in the day. I've tried. I've worked 20-hour days, and I still work 20-hour days, and there's still not enough time for me to accomplish it all. The way I usually describe it to these young girls is that you have to think about, one of my mentors told me this, you think about it as glass balls and rubber balls. I know, feminist talk balls, haha, funny. Middle schoolers would kind of much this. You have glass balls and you have rubber balls, and you're constantly juggling them as a woman. If you're in a career, and you're going to school, and you're a parent, you're a wife, you're constantly juggling them. And your job is you've got to figure out where are your glass balls and where are your rubber balls, because sometimes you're going to have to let things drop. But there are some things, if you let them drop, they will shatter. And it's a constant balance of priorities. And I struggle with this all the time. Like, for example, I signed up to go do this protest in Detroit on Saturday, not realizing I have to get up at 8 a.m. on Sunday and leave for 2 days. So I'm going to see my kids for like 6 hours in 5 days. Idiot me, I should have been like, no, I can't do this. But I'm still not even good at juggling all the balls. We have to understand, as women, that our happiness, that our freedom isn't found in autonomy and what serves ourselves. That's the mantra of feminist mystique. Greek philosopher said freedom is the power to choose the good. Aristotle said that rational beings seek their ultimate end, happiness, by using their reason to judge what will further the end or undermine it. Our real freedom as women, as human beings, is the ability to love, to give, to receive, to serve, to be served. Because we're not made to be islands. Very few of us want to be alone. We live in a world surrounded by other people. We're relationship-driven creatures. Happiness doesn't come by satisfying all of our economic or career desires. Because I'm like, guess what? There's no amount of money you can ever make that you're going to have it all. Every time I get like a cost of living adjustment, I'm like, yes. And then like this month hit, I was like, crap. It's gone. No matter what I do in the pro-life movement or like the really cool things that happen or being on TV or meeting someone who I've looked up to, the cool days, the awesome days when we have success, when a woman chooses life, they're able to serve her. I love those days. I live for those days. But nothing compares to when I'm home and Gracie comes up to me and asks me to put my little curlers in her hair. Nothing compares to coming home and having children with you in your arms. Nothing compares to it. Suzanne Vanker, she wrote in Fox, it was a Fox News op-ed that someone sent to me, and she actually wrote, the feminist worldview is antithetical to love because its focus is solely on the woman, their needs, their wants, their desires, their rights. Love can't possibly be sustained with an attitude like that. It's a great point. So I guess you can say I'm a little angry about the lies the mainstream feminist movement has been telling for 50, 60 years. That sex is without consequences, that hormonal birth control, great, nothing wrong with it. That we need it to control our biology. That abortion is the solution to our struggle of equality that's without risk. And that when we do choose to have children, have a career, it's going to be easy and we can do it all. So where do we go? For those of us who reject the violence of abortion, the reject that we have to tear apart unique, whole, living human beings, those of us who believe in science, where do we go? Are we just trying to control women's bodies? Are we trying to take away their choices, as so many would claim? No. We're fighting for real choice. We're fighting for nonviolent choices, for nonviolent health care. We start with the assumption that pregnancy is not a preventable disease. Obamacare literally made pregnancy a preventable disease. What an insult to women in our nation. My ability to have children is a gift. My fertility is a gift. I have many friends who can't have children at all. And they struggle with infertility. They would give anything to be able to have that child alone. And our government tells us that it's literally a disease. It's not a condition to be controlled with medication. We need to understand that by sending her off alone to that abortionist, saying, it's your choice, is wrong. There's no justice in it for her. The reasons that led her to go to that abortionist, into the hands of the abortionist, they're still going to be there the next morning. She's still going to be poor. She's still going to be in an abusive relationship. Abortion doesn't solve that problem. But just prolonged and compounded her struggle. Instead of seeking to build that real relationship with her, of seeking true social justice, we've outsourced our duty to the Planned Parenthood down the street. And I would argue that it's the pro-life movement, it's this pro-life generation, the majority of young people who reject abortion, they're actually advocating for the support of women and families in need. Because we don't believe in just shipping her off to relieve the crisis. We want her to build a life for herself and for her child. At Students for Life, we have an initiative called the Pregnant on Campus Initiative. It was actually inspired by the work of Feminists for Life. Feminists for Life was actually the first, Sarah Going Serious Parent Foster was the first speech I ever heard in college. And we worked with them to develop this idea of how can we help inspire our Students for Life groups to truly serve women on campuses, beyond just talking about how abortion is bad, but actually changing the culture, making institutional change on those campuses. Our motto at Students for Life is we don't want any woman to ever have to choose between the life of her child and the life she's always dreamed for herself. That it's going to be hard, but there's going to be someone who loves her and stands with her and helps her make it possible. And we're doing this all the time. There was a young girl, Maddie, this spring who reached out to us. She was a senior at Christian High School, 4.0 GPA, had sex, got pregnant, and the school said, okay, you're expelled. Her parents fought back. They allowed her back into school, but they said, well, she has to miss the senior class trip, and she can't walk at graduation. It was the pro-life students, the pro-life generation, that took this story to the New York Times. We showed them that this is not okay. Even though a majority of us are Christian, not all of us at Students Life are Christian, but even though a majority of us are Christian, we're going to speak out against this. Because this is the exact opposite of what Christians should be doing. Now, Maddie's school never relented. They actually lost a lot of students who transferred over to another school. Apparently, there was a big heated battle in Hagerstown for Christian schools, so their school was like cheering us on. They never relented, though. So we actually held an alternative graduation ceremony. We raised $16,000 from our supporters to give her a college scholarship. Maddie gave birth to baby Grayson a couple weeks ago. I got to meet him. He's awesome. He's pretty cool. There was a girl, I'm not going to use her name, but this spring, who reached out to us, who found our Pregnant Campus website on Google. And she said, I'm gonna have to drop out of my community college because I was giving birth during the winter semester, and they said because I did that, I didn't get my class credits, so I don't qualify for financial aid. It took like one letter. It took like 5 minutes of our time to have her financial aid restored, for her to remain in school. But this is the institutionalization that I'm talking about. This is why we need our 1,000 Students for Life groups across the country, changing the environment on campuses. Changing it so women don't have to choose between the life of their child and her education. So do I call myself a feminist anymore? Honestly, with 20% of women using the label anymore, I don't really care about the title. I do know I stand with the majority of American women, 59%, who believe abortion is morally wrong. I do know that I don't want my voice and I don't want my story, my testimony to be co-opted by the mainstream feminists. Abortion movement. I know I want the lies that they sell brought to light. I want women to know that there isn't an either-or choice for them. There's something more. I want women to feel empowered, to understand that their goals and aspirations and careers can be achieved, and we can help them do that. That love and happiness can be found, but it's not all going to be the career. It's not all going to be the money. I want women in our generation to know that nonviolence and equality, those two first main tenets of the first wave feminists, that's who we are as pro-lifers. That's the pro-life label. That's the anti-abortion label. That's the one I care about.
could ask your question and then give Kristen a chance to respond to it. And then following her answer, you can give a response. Okay? So if you have a question, you can go ahead and raise your hand.
I see that throughout much of your speech, it was focused upon, say, the history of the feminist movement from Wollstonecraft to Paul and mm-hmm. such. Is it, that's the good background, you see. But I come from the men's rights movement, and we ask a different question. We don't see our society as patriarchal, but rather as gynocentric. Now, y'all laugh. I mean, when 91% of all prisoners are men, when 82% of the homeless, including me, I'm homeless, are men. So we have a point, okay? Now, the way we think about abortion, and this is the subject what you're talking about in the men's rights movement, is this. We ask the question, how fair is it for women to have full reproductive rights, but no responsibilities that come with reproduction? Now, that would be the free abortion, Planned Parenthood, NARAL position. And we ask, how fair is that when in this gynocentric legal regime, men have no reproductive rights at all? But if we do reproduce, we have an 18-year sentence of child support or whatever comes with marriage and parentage, okay? So it is no rights, but full responsibility for us. And then with the feminist legal regime, it is full freedom, but no responsibility for the women.
So what's your question?
My question is, will you reconsider your approach in giving speeches about abortion to think of also about the men? Now, I know you're speaking to a college
sure.
campus,
mm-hmm.
and 65% of the people here are women because that's where it is on American college campuses today, 65-35 on men, women, or women to men. So,
bring this on. No, for sure. That's something that we do talk about students. We're like, well, I don't really want to comment on the men's rights movement. That's the first time I heard it. But this is a conversation that we have a lot within the pro-life movement. We have like 4 male staffers at Students for Life, and we love our male staffers. And one of our biggest problems our Students for Life groups have is actually recruiting men. After all, somebody has to carry all the heavy stuff. No, actually, I did make some repair myself early today. But no, this is a problem within the pro-life movement. Like, a lot of men feel that abortion is wrong, but they feel like they can't say anything. They're told, sit down, shut up. That's what their mothers have told them. And so we actually do struggle with this in the pro-life movement. We do give speeches and we do give presentation on why it is a male's responsibility to step up. Because when you look at the statistics for abortion, Alan Guttmacher, Institute, when you look at why women have abortions, the vast majority of them are had because of lack of partner support or perceived partner support. I think one of the saddest things is we've had students who call our office where the boyfriend doesn't want her having the abortion. You knew she didn't want to have the abortion, but neither of them actually were courageous enough to actually say those words. And so I think it is a problem that men don't have. You look at Casey versus Planned Parenthood, and men don't have a right. Husbands don't even have to be notified if their wife is going to have an abortion. And that is wrong. I would agree with that. Is there any other questions?
Thank you for coming to Berkeley, Kristen.
Thanks.
Today is Hillary Clinton's birthday.
Yes.
Besides saying...
I have my, this kind of looks like her, right?
Besides saying we're thankful you were born, Hillary, what is the one thing you'd like to say to her, or what is the one birthday present you would like to get to Hillary Clinton?
I would love to defund Planned Parenthood for Hillary's birthday.
Yeah! That's it!
Any other questions?
In your speech, you were kind of kept out, what was conspicuously absent was how you connected your Christian faith with the arguments that you're making.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of think that approaching abortion without reference to kind of the Judeo-Christian worldview can be a tough sell for people, because if they don't understand the dignity of human life to begin with, what is the basis for often refer to your Christian faith, and if not, do you find it challenging?
I often don't refer to my Christian faith when I speak publicly. We are a secular organization, Students for Life. We have a couple of atheists and agnostics on staff. But I think that it is definitely an issue. We had Phil, who's probably watching this, who is our infamous atheist for a few years on staff, and we had lots of heated debates about his faith and or lack thereof. And one of the things that we always talked about was, how did you come to understand that abortion was wrong? Now, in a lot of cases, I've found people who are now agnostic or atheists, they were Christian at some point, and they fall away from their faith later, so they do actually have that Christian worldview, sort of, that human beings are special, that they have dignity, that we're different than a tree. And so I think it's easier for them to connect the dots. It's much harder. Like, I was at a college in Maine a couple years ago, and I shouldn't have done that. I spoke, and like the whole, I had like two friendlies in the audience. There was like 200 people, and then I was like, sure, I'll do coffee. And it was like with the philosophy group at 9 o'clock at night. I was like 8 months pregnant. And I was like, whatever. And it was interesting because I was talking to all of these students who actually were raised inside their homes. And so they had no basis of that Christian worldview that humans do have dignity, and where does that dignity come from? So I think it is a really hard conversation. Like, when I was asked to give a talk at Notre Dame a few years ago, and the Students for Life group there was like, talk about abortion, but don't talk about religion. I was like, okay. And so basically I got down to like, life has value. And I was like, nah, I'm going to tell you why I think life has value, but this is a metaphysical question. So it is hard. I was always raised in a Christian home. I converted to Catholicism a couple years ago, so I wasn't like pro-life because I was Catholic or whatever, and it's part of the Catholic Church's scheme to keep women down or whatever people say. But I would say that I did have that Christian worldview of knowing there is something special about the fact that I'm a human being, that we are different. And you're right, it's a really hard argument to make. But a lot of atheists and folks, agnostics, do have it. Phil, in his case, in order to be philosophically consistent, he actually is like a vegan because he says all life has value. I always joke, and I'd probably get fired for it, like if I was a player in California, because I was like, oh, if you just accept Jesus, your life would be so much better because you could eat meat. But that's how he reconciled it, was, okay, all life has value. And so I got on these really cool tennis shoes at Goodwill because he has huge feet, but he couldn't wear them. Leather. He's completely consistent across the board. He's not the person to have around the community kill a spider. Do you have a question? Sorry.
Yes, I had a question. I saw that you had invited Josh Brom to your national conference.
Yes.
And one of the things he said in one of his videos was that people are more likely to change their mind when they feel emotionally safe. And I was just wondering if you could comment on that, because I was thinking about it, and I can't think of any other social justice issue where we seek to make people feel emotionally safe. So I just wanted to
hear your thoughts. If you haven't noticed, I'm not real good at that whole keeping making people emotionally safe thing.
Yeah.
It's an interesting argument, and the way ERI approaches it, and we've worked with them a lot, is really about, it's the concept of, you want to be able to build some sort of, especially when you're on a campus and there's always people walking by, you want to build some sort of relationship with that person. Because talking about abortion is hard. A lot of times we're talking to someone who's had an abortion, who's been involved in an abortion decision, and they have a real experience. And it's that whole like leadership adage of people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. It's totally true, even with apologetics. And so I have seen it work. I've seen the conversations. He's able to de-escalate the conversations in a way where instead of people screaming at each other and saying, you just want to control my body, they're like, wait, I want to understand where you're coming from, but I'm not the best person to ask about that because I'm not the best person at doing that.
Thanks for being here. Just curious what sort of victories you might have had as far as getting changing tables in bathrooms
on
college campuses or other things to support women who do choose to keep their children and not murder them.
Oh, yeah. No, it's awesome. So I like how you put the murder in the awesome. Cool. So the Pregnant Campus Initiative, a lot of stuff is state or federally mandated that we have to have at universities and public places. So, for example, at Seattle University Catholic School, we found that in the state of Washington, you actually have to have lactation rooms. That took one letter, and like the broom closet turned into a lactation room like the next day. We had an issue at Mississippi State College where we got lactations. There were lactation rooms, but then they were like being used for other things, so they got key cards installed so that moms could actually use them. We had Sacramento State. We have, it's actually one of our first pregnant campus groups. They actually have this thriving pregnant parenting mom support group on campus that meets. It's actually separate from the Students for Life group. We have scholarships. So St. Louis University, Texas A&M University have actually, they pimp out their members to work at all the university's football and basketball games, and they collect all the money and they put it into this pot and they launch scholarships for pregnant parenting women. And what's really cool about that is you don't really need a lot of money. They give out like $500, and the first time they did it, I was talking to their advisor and he was like, yeah, it was $500. He's like, but the one girl was like, I didn't have an abortion because of this. It wasn't the money at the end of the day. It was that someone on our campus cared, and that this was all over campus. There's a scholarship for pregnant parenting students. We have other schools that are trying to get housing. The main thing is a diaper decks and the lactation, because those are a little easier. We can get state fund money for that sometimes. The housing is the huge challenge. The housing and daycare are the two challenges that pregnant parenting students face on campus. A lot of the pregnancy centers in New York City say in May, they have an influx of girls who call needing homes. Because what's happened is they've gotten pregnant, they've delivered, they've kept their baby hidden in their dorm room, and in May, when it's time to move out, they don't want to go home and tell their parents. And so they need somewhere to live. And so that's a huge problem that we have institutionally, of where can you actually live on campus? Who can take care of your child so you can attend class? There's been a lot of really cool social media stories lately of young girls taking babies to classes and professors holding the babies. And we have a policy at Students for Life. We let women have, or men, bring their babies to work up to 6 months until they get like crawly and they get like germs. But yeah, they're not doing anything for 6 months. They're just eating and chilling and pooping. That's pretty much it. So. With Dr. Willie Parker, an infamous abortionist who just wrote this book about basically Planned Parenthood's trying to prop him up as he's like this side preacher, and he's writing like the moral equivalency for why Christians should be pro-abortion. It was an interesting debate because he just fundamentally disagrees with science. He actually believes that, it's scary because he's a doctor and Harvard educated, that he actually believes that the egg and the sperm is when your life began. And I was like, no, those are parts of the bodies and the your DNA, like, I was like, dude, like, I don't know, I'm not as smart as you are, but let me tell you, like, you're missing something. And so we did talk about religion. We talked about our faith and what our faith compels us to do. And what's interesting in his argument was that his faith compels him to commit abortion. And so it was really reminiscent of other atrocities that happened in our world because people say their faith compels them to do things. Yes.
So actually, have
sure. And what's your second question?
And my second question would be, how would you respond to someone who believes that pro-life laws that protect the preborn always oppress women and lead to tragedy and women's death and that sort of thing?
Sure.
And uses El Salvador as an example of that.
Sure. Bali Tommy, yeah, for sure. Pro-lifers believe women can do whatever they want to do with their own bodies. Like, no offense, I don't really care what you do with your body. It's like, I don't think you should smoke, and I don't think you should eat McDonald's every day, but I'm not really going to, I'm a conservative, I'm not going to legislate that. Although I am very liberal in smoking, I would outlaw the issue, so sorry, college Republicans. But with the body of time, it's like, we don't care about women's, what women do with their bodies. They have choice. But once that unique, whole, living human being is created, that's a separate, distinct body. And that body just happens to be living inside of her body. But it's its own, that child has its own body. She can have a penis inside of her, right? When I was pregnant with three boys, it was really weird. I thought that one. I was like, I have a penis inside of me. This is weird. Because it wasn't my penis, it was my son's penis inside of me. It was a unique, whole, living human being growing in my body. So it's not her body. Does that make sense? Now, the laws question, yeah, I mean, obviously that's always an argument that we have to keep abortion legal so that way abortion is safe, because before abortion was illegal and tens of thousands of women died. We know that's actually a false statistic, but our Nathanson, the co-founder of NARAL, actually admitted that he made up that 10,000 stat. Planned Parenthood medical director Mary Calderon, 1960, said that about 500 women a year were dying from illegal abortion. This is Planned Parenthood's own medical director. Why? Because of the invention of penicillin, because the deaths were coming from infection, because they were doing not so great things. She also talked about how the vast majority, in 1960, when abortion was illegal, the vast majority of abortions were being committed by physicians in good standing. They just didn't put a sign outside their door. CDC in 1972 said 39 women died from illegal abortions. So I'd actually say that's not the case. And I also don't think that because some, you can't, people derive sometimes, and I'm not saying this is true, and it should be true, but a lot of times people derive their morality from legality. And a lot of people change their opinion on abortion when it became illegal. They're like, oh, okay, maybe. It's not the way it is. Our morality should not come from legality. Slavery, hello. Like, there are bad laws in our past. So no, we definitely, like, we don't legalize bank robbery because a bank robber could be killed. We know that's wrong. We shouldn't legalize abortion because of that one case or something, some tragedy might happen. We need to save those 1 million children that are being murdered and slaughtered today. Yeah.
Is your conversation with Dr. Parker online anywhere?
Yes, it is. It's terrible quality because, like everything I do in the pro-life movement, best moments, it's always awful quality. He actually ended up, was supposed to Skype in and he phoned in, so he has like a really deep voice. But it was actually a really great conversation. I think we're going to. He's actually offered to debate me, which is really cool because he doesn't debate non-medical people, he says. But it was a good conversation. I think it was a great start.
So I would say I would agree with everything that you said, including Oxford commas. I correct people on that all the time. But I would also actually argue that a lot of what you said could be used in support of feminism and specifically pro-life feminism and why we need to do more to support women, like everything that the pro-life movement is doing, and why, you know, get them to really see that abortion is inconsistent with the rest of the feminist views. So I'm just curious what your thoughts are on pro-life feminism and its place.
Yeah, I mean, you can call yourself a pro-life feminist. I used to do it all the time. I don't anymore. I think there's historical issues with some of it, Marxism, things like that. I think my biggest challenge with feminism, the feminist label, is kind of a practical thing. Film this for Facebook, because everyone's mad at me on Facebook. The biggest issue that I've been seeing with it is we've been doing a lot of research within the pro-life, using the pro-life term, right? So we did a study last year where we found 53% of millennials believe abortion should be illegal in all or almost every circumstance. That's freaking huge, people, because we always want a morality, we kind of always lose a legality. It's always like 58, 48, whatever. We actually had the majority of legality, millennials. But what's interesting is we asked those same people, are you pro-life? 36% said they were pro-life. That told us what we already know on campuses, is that we have a branding problem within the pro-life movement. That when people hear the word pro-life, they're like, I don't know if I want to be one of those. And that's why we're always talking about the pro-life gen and like make pro-life cool again. I would argue we pretty much have. Like, our staff is awesome. I think feminism is also a very damaged brand because it's delved into all of these issues. That's become this aligned thing in with the abortion industry. And the second wave feminists allowed themselves to get to that point. And I think that if you're going to have a serious feminist movement in the country, the focus should be abroad. Because that's where we need to inspire true fights for women's equality. And that's where women are literally dying and being enslaved. And so I would argue that they're actually both kind of messed up brands, and they both need work. And I don't see why, I'm not gonna focus and put my time into trying to revive feminism. I'm gonna focus my time on pro-life, on the anti-abortion, because I want being pro-life to be synonymous with being pro-woman.
I have a question for myself, and then someone Facebook made a question
sure.
to ask you, so I'll try to be quick.
Interactive.
Thank you so much for being here. It is awesome to have a pro-life speaker here at Berkeley, and I'm so glad that it's you. I am involved with Students for Life. I'm the president of Pro Life Future of San Francisco. I'm an atheist. I am a Democrat, and I am very openly a feminist. In the city, in an urban environment, I would say that the percentage of people that identify as feminist is a lot higher than whatever the national numbers would show. And I find that in my activism, speaking about feminism and about the tenets of feminism, of equality, nonviolence, and non-discrimination, have been extremely effective in communicating with pro-choice people about the pro-life position. And I was hoping you could explain a little bit more how you think the way I approach it can be helpful to the movement as a whole, and how we can work with pro-life feminism in the general movement without having to throw out feminism entirely.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking about feminism. I think what's interesting though, what you said though, is you're using feminism as a way to talk about abortion. That instead of saying, hey, I'm anti-abortion, abortion is murdering a human being, you're saying, hey, I'm a feminist, and because I'm a feminist, I'm anti-abortion. And so it's used as a tactic. And that, like, so I did a Facebook post this week, and people got upset because I said, when I used to call myself a pro-life feminist, it was a way to do a qualifier. Like, I'm a pro-life and I'm a feminist. And then people would take, like, that second look, and they'd be like, oh, okay, so she's not a crazy person with a John Brown beard or whatever. But I used it as like a qualifier. And my point is, you know, what I said, I don't think we need to revive both terms. I'm not going to focus on reviving both terms. I'm going to focus on reviving the phrase anti-abortion and pro-life. But I do think you can totally use it. I mean, people have great conversations with them, pro-life feminists. People might see your shirt and I'm like, oh, that's awesome. Because if you label yourself a feminist and people say that, like, oh, that's interesting, that's a different take. I do think we have to be careful that we don't create this identity politics crap within the pro-life movement. For example, today on one of the posts, so there was a bunch of posts in, like, Kristen Mercer Hawkins is like the devil. Happens a lot. Welcome to the pro-life movement. But it was interesting because one of the people who posted was like, any assault, because they're upset because the title of the talk was Lies the Feminists Tell. I'm talking about mainstream feminists, when most people think of feminists. Of course we know there's pro-life feminists. But it was interesting because she said, well, one attack of feminism is attack on all of us. She was identifying herself as a feminist first, and I have a problem with that. There was a leader of another feminist pro-life organization in November who was talking about, there was all these debates about, do you go for Donald Trump, and we didn't talk all night about that. But the argument was, well, I'm a feminist first, pro-life second, and that's the problem. I'm anti-abortion. And I don't care what the label is, I don't care what the cool thing is, I know abortion is the greatest human rights atrocity being committed in the world today, and I'm going to do everything in my power to stop it. And I'm not going to let a label, whether I'm Republican or Democrat, and that's my problem I have with, I've said it publicly with, like, people who say I'm a pro-life Democrat and I vote for pro-abortion candidates. They let being Democrat trump being pro-life. So I don't think I need you happy, but that's my answer. I love you and I respect you, even though we disagree.
Thank you for your answer. I'm going to share a question from Rosemary Garrity, Rehumanize International. She asks, I thought we oppose abortion because it's an act of violence against a human being. Why are you attacking contraception and sex positivity? Is abortion actually a human rights issue, or is it a sexual ethics issue?
Abortion is definitely a human rights issue. But why do we attack, why do I talk about hormonal contraception, something that makes me popular at like zero parties ever? Is because hormonal contraception can actually end the life of a unique, whole living human being. That's why I'm against hormonal contraception. You didn't hear me talk about barrier methods contraception. I'm talking about hormonal contraception. You can read the box of Plan B and it says can prevent implantation. That means that unique, whole living human life has already been created and has traveled from the fallopian tube into the woman's uterus. And they will not let the pill, hopefully the goal, is that embryo cannot plant. That, my friends, is an early abortion. Anymore, I'm really hungry and tired. I mean, today.
Sorry. Thanks so much again for being here. Just curious, you know, in an environment like Berkeley, we're all about identity politics, like you mentioned.
Yeah.
What do you think about the fact that in this country, the population of African Americans is about 13%, and the population of abortion recipients is about 40%? How does that affect your interaction with you?
Well, I mean, yeah. I mean, we have a lot of great African-American pro-life leaders who serve alongside us and involve women. I would argue that we don't have enough, and that's a huge challenge that we face as students for life is, you know, if you have an all-white students for life group, we need to be able to go into the Black student union and make our case and be able to talk about this issue. But there's a huge issue. It's not surprising, though, considering Planned Parenthood was a eugenicist and proud of it. She was a racist. She bragged about the fact that she was a popular KKK speaker. This is where the birth control movement, and this is why you have to tie the two together, that's where it came from. The birth control movement spawned out of the eugenics movement because the eugenics movement believed that certain people were unfit to reproduce. And they had imbecile moron. Have you ever seen those charts of what they thought human beings and their IQs were and who should be able to reproduce? That was why birth control was offered as a solution. It was actually sterilization. Margaret Sanger, the founder of Planned Parenthood, was actually against abortion. Larry Ladder, that her biographer who studied Margaret Sanger and actually got to know her really well, they actually had a huge falling out because he believed in the demographic bomb in the 70s. He thought the world was overpopulated. And he actually thought abortion was a solution. Margaret Sanger was actually against abortion. Even she thought abortion was wrong. So, there you go.
All right, so we're going to have to call it a night, but I want to thank you all again for coming out to UC Berkeley, one of the most progressive schools in the nation, and to help spread the pro-life message here. So let's give Kristen another